So, good morning, everyone. My name is Shivam, and I am solution architect with Jensen. I will just quickly brief me about myself and start with this. So, I have around like 15 years of experience in IT, mostly working on web and mobile technologies. In the last year, I have been now working into data science and machine learning. The talk for this session is demystifying chatbots. Before we begin, just to get an impression of the audience here, how many of you have actually built a machine learning model, trained it? Anyone? Yeah, built and trained it. Okay. And anyone who has worked on NLP part of it? Chatbots, I think everyone have at least encountered one of the chatbot, if not built it. Every bank website, every website, in fact, these days have some or the other chatbots already in there. So just the idea is to get understand what exactly goes behind the scenes when you are actually interacting with a chatbot. Okay. Feel free to ask any questions which you have, and make me stop. So what are chatbots or any voice assistants which you have used? Chat is nothing but a conversational series of messages exchanged. Okay, the WhatsApp chat which you use. And what are bots? Bots are nothing but agents. Agents that task for you. So that together forms a chatbot. There are some numbers on the right. If you have any guesses, what are those? Like 92 million. You know, anyone can take a guess. What does that mean? So messages. 92 million is approximately the kind of smart speakers which will get shipped this year worldwide. So everyone is now talking to your Alexa. The trend. 3.5 billion. Any idea? No, not really. Number of searches made on Google using voice is that 3.5 billion. 80% is, I will just open this up. So 80% is like kind of growth which we are seeing in the unstructured data. When I say unstructured, that is typically text, images, and stuff. Not the regular tabular data which we have. This the kind of growth we are seeing, everyone is now chatting. So that is the textual data. So 80% of growth is now happening in unstructured data. That's where the importance of NLP and machine learning is coming. On the bottom, you have some of the frameworks which if you have been using or your company has been using chatbots. We are going through these platforms. Amazon, Lex, Google Dialogflow is very popular for building those chatbots. Vitae, IBM Watson, Rasa is an open source framework. If someone want to actually build chatbot. So what are different types of chatbots which we have seen? You see, there are actually 4 to 5 levels of chatbots. Right now we are at this stage, the market is still at the level 2 kind of chatbots. Level 1 is like when you are just notifying user of something, let's say. You are getting a salary statement notified on your phone, okay, by a notification. And that is just a basic level of chatbot. Okay, so it's interacting with you, doesn't ask you for any actions or anything. Then comes is where the FAQ-based chatbots, where is it has a predefined scripted response of you ask something and it will look up and just give you the response back. It doesn't understand any intelligence into it. So let's say you ask, what are my, where do I go and look up for phone pay office? It will just make a simple lookup and give you back. Okay. It will not have the intelligence of is PhonePe located around stadiums or not. So it will not go and look for that related with a Balewadi stadium around the data. With no intelligence into it, just a common lookup. Where most of the chatbots these days are. Then level three are where it starts getting interesting, where the chatbots are now getting built. This is contextual chatbots, where it will try to make a dialogue with you. So let's say a simple question of how is weather in Pune? It says that, okay, sunny, bright, 40 degrees. And then suddenly the next question you ask is, and how does it look in Delhi? Now it should understand that context that we are talking about weather. In the next question, there is no weather word. Still, it understands that because you are coming from weather discussion, you are still in that context. That is the contextual conversation happening. And going ahead in the next 5 years, maybe the way technology is shifting, 3 to 5 years, we will have very smart bots and agents which will do a lot of stuff for you, understand a lot of context. So rule-based chatbots are the level one, level two bots where you're just defining, you have a dictionary, you put in that, okay, if user asks this, just give us this response. You're not putting any into it. And then AI-based, if the future will be, if you start understanding context of the conversation, it will have a very human-like intelligence. Just like we understand how we interact and make a dialogue, the chatbots will also start understanding that. It will have NLP and NLGs. NLG is natural language generation, NLP is natural language processing. So level four is where it will start getting personalized. Okay, so based on your profile, let's say it will have a smart integration where it can look what the user is, what is his profile, and based on that, it will start serving responses. And level five is autonomous organization of assistants. So it is not where the bots will not be of a particular intent or a particular domain. So just like developing a weather bot or a travel bot, you will have a single bot which will understand all these different contexts. Maybe more enterprise level bots. We are at level two and level three. We are kind of at level two, and now with the applications are getting built at level three. We are now, if you see some of the good chatbots, they are actually trying to do a lot of context-driven intelligence. So what all, at a very high level, what all pieces goes into building a chatbot? On the left, you have different clients. You interact on a Facebook Messenger, on a WhatsApp, or a your own website has bots, that agents, assistants, and whenever user types something, it goes to some of your application backend, and which passes that message, whatever user has typed, to this whole back ML platform thing which you see. This is where all the machine learning part comes into it. Now, if you see at the very high level, there are three major blocks which are there. First is the NLU, which is natural language understanding. So first thing is, whenever user speaks something or type something, how do you understand what he is saying? Is the request processing or the NLU component does that for you. Okay. Once it has understand what, okay, this is what user is trying to say, it passes it on to dialogue manager, which tries to hold a dialogue between the different messages. Okay. So let's say, like the weather example which I gave, whether in Pune, and then the next question, whether in Delhi. It will try to make sure that it is under the same conversation. Okay? So keeping track of that conversation is the responsibility of the dialogue manager. And what to respond back to user is where the NLG comes into it. How will, let's say user asks whether, then respond it back with whether sunny, warm. So what to give back as a response is your response generation component. So these are very high level major blocks which goes into building a channel. Of course, you will have a knowledge base where your specific application logic will be there, and you integrate with some other, let's say, location of phone pay, you will have to integrate it with Google GPS surrounding information. Those integrations will be there. So every of these three blocks will have some or many machine learning models which will go into there. So let's say your NLU component. Now it has multiple machine learning models, like there is an intent classifier, there is an entity recognizer. Okay. All these models get built and packaged together as an NLU. Similarly for dialogue now, lot of deep learning neural network models which are going there. So the first thing which happens is whenever you are building a chatbot is trying to understand what user is saying. So let's say I want to build a chatbot for flight bookings. Okay, I have a travel bot. User comes to my bot and says that, okay, book me a flight from Pune to Delhi for next week. Another user may come and say it the same thing, but in a different way. Let's say need to travel to Delhi this weekend. Or maybe planning a trip to capital city, where he's not even mentioning Delhi in Delhi. Okay. The first thing is to understand what user is saying. And that comes under, whenever a message comes from the user, you process it and first identify what is the intent of the user is asking. Okay. So in all these three messages, the intent is still the flight booking. However, the way it has been said by the user is different. Okay. That is the difference when you are developing a chatbot versus you're developing a web application or a mobile app. Because the web or a mobile, you are driving the way user will interact with your system. So you are giving him the menus, you are giving him the scrolls and everything. You know where the user will go. But here the user can take any path, because it's upon user on what he will type, what he will text. Okay. So the bot should be intelligent to understand what user is trying to say. What happens when once user types this, is your machine learning model, which is typically an intent classifier model is built. Intent classifier is nothing but a supervised machine learning problem for text classification. Okay. This is classified to belong to one of the labeled categories, which is typically called intents. So let's say I need to travel to Delhi. So now my intent is flight booking. But if I say, how is weather in Pune? The intent is not for flight booking. Intent is to ask for the weather information. So you differentiate your message based on which type of intent user is actually asking. It's a classification problem. Now, if you go into NLP processing pipeline, you will understand how to convert that textual message into getting the data ready for a machine learning. You tokenize each word of your incoming message. So let's say need a flight for Delhi. So you take each word, use a word embedding. Embeddings are nothing but vectors which are semantic or syntactically similar are grouped together. So there are a lot of pre-trained models which are already there, like Glow or whatever. It does this for you. Okay, so you can use them to create those embeddings. If you want, you can also train a model from scratch to generate your embeddings, but that will require a lot of training data. So let's say if you have a Wikidata corpus, and the model which has been pre-trained with that will have a more intelligent embeddings than if you want to train it from scratch, you will have to have that much amount of data with you. Okay. So in the context of embeddings, let's say oranges and apples. Now these will have very similar because they are both of kind of a fruits. So when you embed it, they will have a very syntactically and semantically similar vectors. So then you embed each individual word and then you average it to get a embedding for your whole sentence. Now once you have that embedding for your sentence, then you actually pass it on to a support vector classifier kind of model or logistic regression model. to actually classify what is the intent of the user. So, so you have created your training data with a lot of examples. Let's say that, okay, if user says need a flight booking, is intent is flight booking. I need to travel, intent is still flight booking. So all these are training data which you have collected. Then similarly, you have collected data for different other classes, okay? Let's say for weather and other. So after the user says something, you classify it, whether it, the intent is one category or the other. That is where this model will come in. Now you have understand that, okay, the user is trying to ask for a flight booking. I think that's a lot for similarity. So if you see travel, as you will have more data, the if you see the embeddings will start making clusters. So travel, all the messages regarding travel will start getting into one side of it, so that you can actually classify it. After you have understand that, okay, user is trying to book a flight ticket, the next thing you want to understand is what are the entities which the user has passed in the message. So if the user says, I need to travel to Delhi tomorrow morning for sales meetings. Now, Delhi is the keyword here. Okay, so you need to understand what is Delhi in that, or what is tomorrow in that, or these are entities, basically important information which the user has given to you for processing. So there is an entity recognition model, which again you need to build in. So extract name entities from information and categorize them like location or general place of interest. GP is the spacey use that GP is a general place of interest. Tomorrow is a date field. Okay, so these are named entities in that message. So you have to extract that. So to extract these entities, you only have to apply, of course, the NLP processing pipeline. You tokenize each word, you apply a named entity recognition for that. Okay, so you have to pause tag, chunking, and all those stuff. So all these are algorithms for machine learning which are in the NLP. And then once you have done that, then a CRF model is trained to detect relevant entities in the query. Create a training data for doing this entity recognition, you have to first annotate your data. You have to prepare your data first. So let's say you give an example of your training data has a lot of examples. So you need to first annotate that, okay, Delhi is a location. Paris is a location, or New Delhi is the location which is similar to Delhi. So you have to give these examples. Okay. So the way to train is this IOB, which is inside a tag, outside tag, a begin of a tag. These are the structures which you for entity recognition. Right. Yeah. So you have to label your data. So building a chatbot, you need to provide it a training data wherein you need to label it. So let's say now this example I have that my user may say like this. I will give it an example. Like, okay, Delhi is a place of interest. Okay, now let's say I cannot give all the cities' names and keep on creating examples for it. Right? So there are million of cities. Let's say I need to travel to Timbuktu. Let's say I will not have a labeled data for that. But that's where the embeddings come into place, wherein if you have a very large trained, pre-trained embeddings which you have used, they understand that Delhi and Timbuktu both are cities. So they are in the similar context. Okay, so they extract that entity and say that, okay, this looks to be a city with certain probability. Entity recognition is just trying to find out what are the different important keywords in that message. Okay? It can be a city name, it can be a date is also important because you need to book a ticket for some date, right? So you know that, okay, date is something which I need. Whatever in the original data set which you are using, Whatever entities are there, it will classify that, okay, this looks to be a place, this looks to be a, some it may even not recognize, like sales, it doesn't recognize. Okay. If you want, you have to then again train your data with more such examples. That this is another entity which I want, which is a custom entity. Now these are very generic entities, like everyone, every other chatbot will require this. A place or a date or a currency or a dollar, whatever. These are many system level entities. But if you are developing your own bot where you have something which is very custom to your application, you will have to create data for that.
Right.
So both ways. So you can use a pre-trained model as well as if you want to have something custom, you'll have to train it and then build it. Now you have understood what user has said. You have found out what are the important things he's trying to pass it to you. Okay. Then the next very important component is dialogue management, where you start holding a conversation with the user. So let's say I'm trying to build a flight booking bot. Now user says, okay, I need to travel to Delhi next weekend, but I also need to understand him what is the exact date. How many passengers will you, is he traveling alone or do he want morning flight, evening flight? All these are things which I still need. Okay? So I need to hold a conversation with the user. I need to go back and again ask him something to get information. Okay. So that's where the dialogue management starts coming in. This is basically pattern-based rules to determine the dialogue state for you. So let's say if user says that, okay, traveling to Delhi, so the next question will be, what date? Okay, so then he passes on the date. Then you ask, okay, which flight you want, or let's say how many passengers? So all different conversation. Which, the way conversation will flow is decided using this component. Okay, a user may deviate from the happy path. Let's say user is talking about flight booking and suddenly he switches, can you order a pizza for me? User may say that. Okay, so how do you handle those scenarios? Now you are not using a pizza booking bot or a pizza ordering, in fact. So how do you handle those scenarios where the user has navigated away from the goal which you have developed your bot for? So you have to either let the user come back to that goal by asking the right questions, or you say that, okay, I don't service this request or something. Dialogue management is done typically through two, three important things. One is SWOT. SWOT is minimum data which is required to fulfill that goal. Like for flight booking, intent requires source, destination, data, date, and passenger details and things like that. These are the minimum information, let's say, I want if I want to actually book. Tracker keeps track of the current state of the conversation. So your bot should be intelligent to understand that, okay, I've already asked him, let's say, date previously. He has already mentioned that, okay, I want to travel tomorrow. You will not go and again ask him what is the date on which you are traveling, because he has already mentioned that. So you have to keep a track of it. Okay. What you have previously already received an answer for it, and what are the next things which you want. Tracker is that. Policy is where you decide on basically what happens if the user deviates from the happy path. So you have to again let him user come back to the original EA. So there are again strategies for doing that. So there's a fallback policy. Let's say user is repeatedly asking questions which are not relevant. So after two, three attempts, you may politely request, deny his request that, okay, I'm not serving this request or something like that. Or maximum history to use, like how many previous conversation you will remember. LSTM is long short-term memory based RNN models are used for this. This is theoretically, I'm telling you the NLP. I'm not going into the details of the code because that will be very lengthy to go through all the models. So this is the priority rules, how you handle the dialogue rules. Let's say user has given a message. which doesn't have any intent, or you have not even identified any entity in that message. So that always is the very low priority message. A much, much more priority is someone where a rule has a, when I say domain, domain is nothing but a, like flight booking is a domain. Travel bot is a domain. Intent is the flight booking. Based on specificity, number of information which user has passed or you have already gathered from the user, accordingly the conversation should become more specific. So right, like the first, the user has not given any particular information at what he is trying to do. It's a very general purpose conversation. As you start getting more and more things, start becoming very specific. Okay. So, and it is now when we have actually identified that it has asked this, I have to ask the next action should be, let's say I want to ask him, should I go ahead and book a ticket for you? So all those, what to ask user back is handled by the NLG component, which can also have predefined text for you. Or you can, if you want to go and develop your own models, and then you can use some language models for NLG. And again, there are multiple models for that. But how do you now measure your chatbot? So you have developed a chatbot. How do you actually measure that? Okay, it is actually helping or it's serving the purpose for which you have built a bot. So now there are different KPIs for building. So for the development team or the modeling team, the KPI is just like for any other classification algorithms. The confusion matrix or the precision values, the recalls. How many times user is actually detecting right intent? Okay. How many times it is misclassifying it? Okay. What is the F1 score or the recall score? That is very technical KPI, but for the business, the KPIs may be different. Was the user goal completion rate? So if the user came to your bot with a flight booking and whether he was successful in booking that bot or not, how many times did that happen? After using your bot, is the user again coming back in future again for using bot or not? These are more from the business oriented KPI, but they will be more interested in that. Callback rate is your bot is not able to understand what user is trying to say, and it passes on to talk to our agent or talk to our call center or whatever. How many times that is happening? Question there? Okay. What are some of the challenges which you will have? So handling out of vocabulary words. The question which you had, not every word which user will say will already be in your corpus, or you had already trained with that. There will be a lot of other words which will come up. How do you handle those scenarios? So if you have very specific custom domain specific words, you train your model again with those corpus and use it together with your existing word vectors. If there are multiple intents with the same message. Let's say user says that, hey, it looks a lovely morning, how is the weather in London today? Okay. Now, hey is actually a greet. Intent is, he's greeting your bot. Hi. And then the other sentence is, I want to understand what is the weather. The two intents which are coming together in the same sentence. The user may ask like that. So how do you handle those scenarios? Now, adjusting threshold value. So let's say a user asks to say something which your model understands that, okay, it looks to be multiple intents, but with a very similar property. Let's say it understands that, okay, looks like that user is want to book a flight booking with some 80% probability, but he may be looking for more for hotel booking at Delhi. He may not use the word flight. Yeah, so it may have a hotel booking with 70% probability. So how do you handle these scenarios? So that intent classification model, it will give you some score, right? confidence of that. Skewness, I think in the last session also we had discussed that. So if you have imbalanced data, so I have given a lot of training examples of one particular intent, the flight booking, but very less example for getting status of whether my flight is on time or delay. A very less training examples of that. So how do you handle this scenario? Of course, every intent it will try to understand that he is trying to book. He is not trying to book, he's actually trying to understand whether the flights are on time or delayed. Limited training data, because you cannot think all the possible scenarios which user can speak. So how will you train it? So the only thing is you have to keep training. You collect whatever the way the user has conversed with you, and again train your model with the new data. Keep collecting that data and do with it. Then adapting to user mood. Some these are like very smart bots where you understand that okay, user is sad mood or is very angry with you. So how do you service those kind of users? Using some false words in the messages or the kind of scenario. So you take the corpus and then you, if you have very specific your particular words, you again include those examples for those words, okay, and then start the training again to complete a new embedding. I mean, this is one of the ways you can do multiple ways of handling out of words, out of vocabulary words. Like you also give some examples where you mark it as that, okay, this is out of vocabulary, and see how your bot is performing. Is it understand that, okay, if I have something which is out of vocabulary, how do I handle those scenarios? Yeah, so I think. Questions? So these others are the, I think, the Amazon and Google ones. So that's where the session is to demystify what is actually going behind. You don't understand. So let's say you use dialogue flow. They just ask you that, okay, give your examples, and it will build a chatbot for you. But you don't understand what all machine learning models are going behind it. Okay. RASA is open source. There are other RASA, right? The ones which I have used is Cisco's MindBuild. If you have seen it, write it down. It's also an open source. You take your RASA framework, and then if you want to customize it, you can go and build over it.
You have to differently train for that,
right?
And then to have the entity recognition from that thing, you again have to separately train for it.
Right.
Then in the third, that is the ML understanding by dialogue management. In that, you said you were using deep learning LSTM and RL learning models for there. So that is basically correlating with the knowledge base and the actions. From there, you take the field, and depending upon that, the history of the community, you will get the feedback, right? So that training data set is also different.
Right.
So these are the three different training data sets. So say if I have to generate the NLG, basically, so I have to take consideration what intent it has asked, and from the knowledge base, I have to take the most appropriate answer for that thing. Right. So how are you developing that particular knowledge base database?
Knowledge base is nothing but it's kind of a normal dictionary, let's say, of my particular words or my domain specific logic which I want to build in. You can use there are a lot of knowledge graphs and other stuff as well these days, but you, for a very basic simple, yeah, you can use a normal, let's say I can use even a Python dictionary, let's say itself. So if user is asking, If user is asking that, okay, get me the weather for today. No, I can, the action which I have identified is, okay, I need to do call a weather API lookup. Okay, and then let's say the weather API gives me in whatever way humidity perception. Now that humidity in my knowledge base, I can map it. Okay, humidity is in my, for my users to explain it, I can call it something differently. Okay, so that mapping, I can keep it in my knowledge base. So it can interact with that.
Right. Ask the user to give the response.
Right.
It can any website.
So that is my application specific logic. So my knowledge base. Because I have built my, I understand that my users doesn't understand the word humility. Humility, they understand, like, say, perception or whatever, perception. That knowledge is what I have. Okay. So I can refer that.
What are the different
possibilities? So that is anyways handled by your messaging backend. So if your user is interacting with a voice, you have developed a voice bot, yeah, Siri, so you have to convert it back to your speech to text or text to speech, whatever. NLG, like if you have trained your own language model, okay, so then you can use NLG based models to generate those dynamic responses. Okay, but you can also use, let's say I can have that, okay, we just say flight booking, this is what I have to respond back. Okay, so I can keep my predefined answers as well.
For the booking, the standard, like for the NLG to keep the response. Like if I send them a voice, the Alexa is there. So that is the input coming. Similarly, Alexa is also responding to it. Okay, so if I take the top end of the voice based conversation.
I'm not sure, but there are multiple speech to text.
Yeah,
text to speech.
What are the different possibilities? Like voice is there, then we can do chat also, yeah, or web based interactions also possible. So all those we can do third party also.
Right.
Not only to derive from scratch and integrate
that. Yeah, yeah. So in fact, most of the thing you will have to reuse it.
Yeah.
If you're trying to build it from scratch, that itself is a project. If you're trying to build a word embedding equivalent to Wiki, that itself is a 6-month project. That will, you will be able to develop a chatbot much faster if you use those things. Right. So if only you need that, okay, your bot is not giving accuracy, you need to further train it with more data specific to your application domain, then only you go and open it and train it. Otherwise, you can always use whatever they have provided with you. You can use any other models as well. Generally, it's a sequence. So, yeah. Right. So that's where the LSTM is used.
I mean, if you actually are talking in terms of flight or anything, you need to have those particular intents. You cannot completely have the, all the set of possibilities and intents.
That's what we say, that you cannot think what all different ways user will go and interact with your system, right? So you start with the basic training data which you have. You train your model, you deploy it, and then you see the way user is interacting. Again, train it once you have collected more data. So that is the retraining part.
Yeah,
so when you have collected your data, or let's say your bot is live and you have a bunch of interaction of your users. Now you know that, okay, after this point, my bot is failing. It is not trying to understand. Okay, so you take that data, now you train it with that data again. Then you have to build your knowledge base more. Right. It's always incremental, machine learning models. Any model which you take, you have to keep retraining it. It is not one-time process. Did it and then you're done. So if you want to actually build your own chatbot from scratch, so there are open source frameworks, there are multiple in fact these days, but Rasa is very popular. You can also use MindMeld. Particular to chatbot, there's nothing specifically. It's more of NLP modeling, if you have to understand. Okay? So the chatbot is just an application of it. The internals are still the NLP specific models which you have to understand. Okay? And for that, you can use multiple, I mean, there are blocks, analytics with their KD nuggets. You can use those in for that. I'm not aware of any particular way that puts it all together at one place. Spelling mistake is again an example of out of vocabulary. Let's say a user has spelled it incorrectly, and so your bot doesn't understand that word. Okay? So it is again out of vocabulary case. What will you do with that? Again, there are fuzzy wuzzy and other matching algorithms to handle those spelling mistakes. You can train it. That's what I've said now. Also, when you're training, you give some examples where you specify that, okay, this word is, let's say, out of vocabulary. So that your bot is understanding that, okay, there may be instances where I don't understand that word. And that is the case of spelling mistakes. Yeah. Right. So that is the fallback policy of the dialog management. So if you're not trying to understand, you again ask the user, you still don't understand, let's say, what will you do? So you have to drive the conversation like that.
So
there's no assumption as such. You should always ask user for the specific. So that's why there's a specificity is there. So the user has just said, I'm traveling. So now there's no intent which you have identified. There's no entity which he has given. So that is a very, very open-ended statement. So that will always serve with a very low probability.
So that is
your application. Now logic is where it is. So let's say you are booking it, you are developing the bot for flight booking. So you know that you only serve that purpose. Okay. So you can ask the next set of intelligent question that, okay, I can help you with the flight booking. For the rest, you can talk to our customer care or whatever way you want to handle it. Again, if you go into neural network and TensorFlow models and other stuff, so now they are handling that multiple intent in the same statement type of scenarios. You have to build a lot with lot of those examples.
Basically,
it's a story. Slowly, after one conversation, one person, until it completes the objective.
Do you consider that story also in some way training?
Yeah, so you have to give those stories. So that's what the path which user will take is your training data. Okay, so you have to build those stories and train it. But the only thing is, you cannot give all the possible scenarios in which user will talk. Okay, so that's where your model performance will start improving as you will give it more data.
So I have
not used graph as such. I mean, graph databases. Yeah, there are a lot of people who are using that. It can be anything. No? You can have it. That's what I said. You can have a simple Python dictionary as well. In a dictionary, I can keep all the possible. Okay, this word has these meanings, let's say. That is a knowledge graph.